How do you design culture? Society has taken many forms throughout the millennia of human existence. Cultural norms that are established come from iteration, consensus, and communication. It defines our traditions, our customs, and values. Culture can influence our forms of technology, our modes of communication, and our artistic expression. Our cultures are defined by our religious beliefs, our philosophical stances, our political ideologies, and so much more. So if I gave you the task of designing a culture by hand, how would you go about building it? And if you could, how would you then task a computer with designing unique cultures for you to explore, all within the confines of a video game? I'm Tommy Thompson, and welcome to AI in Games, a series on research and applications of artificial intelligence in video games. In this episode, we explore the inner workings of Ultima Ratio Regum, a roguelike that has been the personal quest of one individual for almost 10 years. To build a game that can procedurally generate the most culturally detailed worlds possible, comprised of societies with their own political and religious ideologies, their own dialects and material expressions, all in a vast open world for players to explore and interact with. In late 2020, I had the pleasure of sitting down with the game's creator, Dr. Mark Johnson, as he reached a significant milestone with the release of version 0.8 of Ultima Ratio Regum. We discussed the complexities of the game he has designed, how someone with no knowledge of game development sought to create this unique experience, and the highs and lows of dedicating 10 years of his life towards achieving his goals. Ultima Ratio Regum is a roguelike that aspires to do something rather distinctive, to procedurally generate game worlds that are not just bespoke to that playthrough, but the backstory behind it, be it the notable figures, conflicts, religions, politics, and other cultural practices, are the backbone of the experience. Players are tasked with solving a mystery, a conspiracy hidden throughout history that requires players to find clues throughout the game world by visiting different cultures and exploring them, either by chatting with people in the cities, or by exploring the religious altars, or scouring the sarcophagi of the royal and military leaders. The name of the game itself is a Latin phrase denoting the final argument, or in the context of conflict, the last resort. The term Ultima Ratio is a short form of the metaphor, the last resort of kings and common men, with the addition of the term Regum removing the common man from the equation. Hence Ultima Ratio Regum, the last argument of kings. It's a phrase often embraced in the real world as a motto for military units, including the 1st Battalion 11th Marines of the United States, the Swedish Artillery Regimentet, and was reportedly inscribed on the cannons of the armies led by King Louis XIV of France, the longest ruling monarch in European history. The game itself is an open world comprised of a map of 250 by 250 tiles. Each of these tiles itself breaks into 200 by 200 tile spaces to move around in, resulting in a game world comprised of 2.5 million tiles that are procedurally generated one time for each new playthrough of the game. Each world map is comprised of multiple nations. Each nation is comprised of settlements. You can enter a city and see the districts built within it. Each district is separated into specific building types. You can then zoom in further and go into buildings, read books in libraries, admire pottery, visit the graves of the dead, and talk with the locals to learn more about the world. And that's just for one city, with the game on average generating 18 cities per world map, each with their own civilization, religion, cultural artifacts, and dialects. But while the scale is already quite breathtaking, the most impressive facet of Ultima Ratio Regum is how procedural content generation is used to build each of these civilizations in very smart interconnected ways. This approach, referred to as qualitative procedural generation, is built to support the idea that objects, even in video games, should not be created in isolation, but are instead related to one another. Fundamental to URR's world-building processes and the creation of meaning within them is the idea of chains of meaning. Nothing, or at least very little, is intended to appear in the world that is only related to itself, or only related to one other element. Now, what does all this mean? Well, if you consider the flora and fauna systems that generate plants and wildlife in the open world, if a particular animal or plant is generated within a region, it can influence the possibility that others might appear alongside it. Conversely, it could also prevent specific species from appearing in that region, given that would contradict the biomes that are being generated. This then goes one step further, If you visit the local town nearby, a healer may refer to a plant in that region as a remedy for specific ailments. It could influence their religion, with their beliefs or symbolism making reference to the topography or the wildlife of the region. It could even influence language, as dialects use bespoke phrases that not only refer to the world around them, but are unique to that culture. It's a game that is as grandiose as it is intimate, and it all stems from a procedural generation system with layers upon layers of complexity. While Mark has spoken about the game on many occasions, be it academic conferences, roguelike events, in textbooks and conference publications, there is also the very human element of trying to build a game of such scale and complexity and the challenges that presents. URR started development late in the summer of 2011, the same year that Johnson started his PhD at the University of York in the UK. However, unlike many of the other enthusiastic games academics come developers we've came across in this series, from the likes of Angelina's creator Michael Cook to more recently Joris Dorman and his work on Unexplored, Johnson's background isn't in computer science, but rather sociology. Johnson graduated with a PhD in Science and Technology Studies in 2015 and has subsequently built a career as a games researcher with a notable interest in the challenges and complexities faced by the ever-growing cultures and economies that surround esports and live streaming. At the time of this video, Mark is a lecturer in digital cultures at the University of Sydney in Australia. And so here we are, almost 10 years after the game began development, and Ultima Ratio Regum version 0.8 was released back in December of 2020, with some minor bug fixes since. This update was a huge undertaking, with the game now including non-player characters and settlements, procedural face generation that gives variation based on cultural beliefs, as well as genetic variations, a conversation system complete with bespoke dialects and mannerisms, procedural clothing where the outfits of citizens will also fluctuate depending on their culture or religious affiliations, and much, much more. It's a hell of a patch, but it's one that has taken much of the past 5 years to build. And so a couple of weeks before release, I sat down with Mark to talk not just about this patch, but the early beginnings of the game, its inner workings, and all of the challenges, be they technical or personal, he has overcome along the way.
I mean, I would love to claim that I had this kind of massive procedural cathedral planned from day one, but that would not be true. I believe what happened was just I came across this tutorial for how to make a roguelike in Python, and for some reason I just thought, yeah, that sounds like fun. And that was basically the entire thought process. I just thought, yeah, sure, why not? I had never programmed anything before this, but I had modded a lot of games, and so I had some like sense of what I was doing in some on some level. I quickly kind of really enjoyed the sensation of being able to change things very easily and to quickly spin off into something very, very different from the tutorial. Like, I think at first I programmed in a kind of a system for having monsters judge how scared they are based on how many hostile monsters are near them. And that created this really intriguing kind of equilibrium where creatures would have kind of standoffs and would kind of approach and then back off and these sorts of things. And that took me, let's say, two hours to make. And yet it created a kind of dynamic system which I'd never really seen in a roguelike. And so I think that kind of thing, that quite quickly and quite early, I thought, huh, it's actually not that hard to kind of create new stuff or to try new things. And then I suppose after that, there was about a six-month period where I guess I was making something extremely Dwarf Fortress-esque. Quite soon I realized, I realized we don't need another Dwarf Fortress because we already have one. And B, I realized that the roguelike world has a lot of sort of clone projects, and I didn't feel like the roguelike world needed another clone project as well. And so then I sort of started to think about whether I could do something weird and different. And that coincided with me beginning to get a little bit better with Python and beginning to explore this kind of procedural graphics idea with ASCII art. And the first time I showed off some kind of PCG ASCII graphics, the internet really liked it a lot. And that made me think, okay, this is the thing my game will be, because no one's really done this. This is something which I find very rewarding to make, and this is something other people seem to like. And so that seemed to be a really good pairing to kind of build the game around. And then over time, the PCG graphics expanded into kind of other sort of PCG stuff, which most roguelikes don't do, like speech or religions or this type of stuff.
And so from the very beginning, this notion of complex worlds with bespoke aesthetics and cultural artifacts began to take shape. But one of the things that's always stood out about URR is that Mark has always said in talks and publications that the game was intended as a 10-year project. In fact, the first time I met Mark was back in 2014 during one of his presentations on the game at the Proc Jam event in London. And already the game was, as he himself stated, 3.5 years into a predicted 10-year timeline. But it's not often you hear a game be described as such, or for someone to commit to such a prolonged development cycle. Saying to yourself in advance, this is a 10-year game and you're intent on making good on that ambition, sounds awfully pragmatic.
I felt that that was a realistic scope, and to be honest, if I hadn't had some serious health issues, it probably would have been, actually. Because even with a lot of what I think we euphemistically call challenges, I've still got 80% of what I wanted there done within the 10-year period. So without that shit, am I allowed to swear on AI and games? But yeah, I wasn't really interested in making something smaller because, like I say, I've always been kind of attracted to the big, grand, mad piece of art. I guess there was a little bit of, once I discovered this kind of procedural graphics stuff, and then to a lesser extent, the other kind of culture PCG stuff, I felt like I really wanted to take that as far as I could take it, basically. And I felt that wasn't something which would be like a one-year dev cycle and then you release a game which has a few PCG swords or something. Like, if I wanted to do it, I had to really go for it and really PCG every graphic in the game and how everyone talks and how everyone looks and all this type of stuff, yeah. I've often been criticized by online people who are less generously inclined as kind of always extending what the game should be. But the genuine truth is, after about 2 years in, the ambition didn't really change much from there. It was just a matter of getting it done. I think in hindsight, the how long is a piece of string issue definitely was there at the back of my head, especially when you have like a really compelling but pointless PCG system which you could work on, or something really uncompelling but something really crucial. I definitely found it hard to choose option two when those choices arose.
Now, from everything described thus far, Ultima Ratio Regum sounds horribly complex. But once you dig into the details, and by that I mean read into the actual codebase, or of course ask the fella who made it, you discover that a lot of it is fundamentally quite simple, and perhaps even contrary to the creator's own beliefs, the subject of some effective design decisions. As Johnson himself admits, he's not a professional programmer, but while his technical skills have grown, the background required to build these culture simulators was much more fleshed out and established.
Yeah, I mean, I don't come from a techie background at all. There was a point where someone tried to teach me to program in BASIC on the Spectrum when I was about 5, but I found it intensely frustrating because I was 5. Probably. And I mean, I think a lot of this also just stems from the fact that although I have made mods and so on, this is the first game I've ever programmed. I learned Python while making it. I knew less than nothing about how to write good code, and I still don't. I come from a much more kind of political science-y, sociology-y, philosophy-y kind of background. And also, I like my undergrad is in politics and sociology, and my PhD is in sociology. I had read a lot of this stuff for my own interest already. I had read a lot of anthropology of religion. I'd read a lot of political science, all this type of stuff. As what URR was going to be coalesced, I thought that that was, again, kind of something quite new and fresh and different, which I felt I could bring, which, although, like, PCG game makers and roguelike makers are an unusually PhD-heavy bunch of people, it tends to be, of course, comp sci or maths PhDs. And so someone from a very different background again, I felt that was something intriguing and different and new. So a lot of that I already had. There were definitely a few points where I would go and kind of look up really obscure bits of political social theory, but for the most part, it was very much that stuff rather than any kind of tech knowledge which I started the project with. Yeah.
All of the generators in Ultima Ratio Regum follow a method typically referred to as template-driven or constructive procedural generation. This means that a generator has a set of rules, and even predefined pre-built chunks or samples from which to build from. Rather than having each item pre-built and ready to go, there are thousands of painstakingly handcrafted sets of features that can be used for specific generative systems, and the pseudo-random number generator helps ensure some variety. To take a popular example, the room tiles in Mosmouth Spelunky are all pre-built, but a lot of subsequent actions are applied to each room tile to change them up and make them feel more unique on each playthrough. This emphasis on variety still enables for enough diversity, provided that the range of templates you work from is sufficiently broad. So let's take a look at a specific example in Ultima Ratio Regum, the creation of family crests. The crest or shield generator has a number of existing pre-built components from which it can then use to create the final piece. This includes pre-built templates on the design of the shield, each with their own rules on the layout, size and shape and key features. Then there is the specific graphic or crest on the shield itself, whose availability are influenced by the type of shield design. Once we get to the design of the graphic itself, there are a lot of further options. We could have a gargoyle, a skull, the sun, or even a snowflake, to name but a handful of the dozens available. Each of these graphics carry specific traits, such as the type of properties used in the language of the family motto, or what the family perceives as their strengths and virtues, not to mention the ASCII art for the graphic itself. So, as particular options are selected in the creation of the crest, it prevents specific properties being used, but also enables others. This, of course, requires a lot of time and effort during development to ensure there is a sufficient range in the properties visible. Even in this one example of family crests, there are 5 different shield designs and over 70 unique graphics that can be used. The design types can enable for multiple graphics per shield, and even the colours used when drawing the art to the screen is influenced by the decisions made along the way. This process is largely replicated across all generators in the game. It's just how the pre-built chunks are established and the rules for connecting them that vary. If we consider one of the more complicated systems from the 0.8 release, the procedural speech and dialogue system for NPCs, the same rules apply, but it's just the rules and templates established are more nuanced. Every character in URR speaks English, but each culture has its own dialect. To facilitate this, the dialect will have its own set of nouns. Syllables are created by lumping sets of letters together, and then names are crafted by stitching multiple syllables together. These names can be used for locations, objects, and even people. The naming conventions can vary with each culture, given they may stitch syllables in pairs or triplets. Furthermore, each culture can create its own unique set of greetings, insults, and compliments, and when responding to questions prompted by the player, the responses can vary in depth and complexity, based on an idea of how verbose that dialect is. So while some cultures may speak to you with rather flowery language, others may seem more curt or direct. But the number of pre-built templates is only one critical part of ensuring a rich and diverse set of possible outcomes. It's also about the probability distribution of how frequently these items appear. Do all the family crests run risk of looking similar to one another? What are the odds that two cultures use markedly similar dialects? This is always a challenge with procedurally generated games, given you want to maintain a sense of familiarity while continuing to provide novelty in each run. For Johnson, the intent was to go in the other direction, and ensure that every new culture feels as bespoke and sufficiently different from all others that appear in your current playthrough.
A lot of PCG games have kind of flat generators, and what I mean by that is maybe there's 10 outcomes and each one happens 1 in 10 times, that type of thing. Whereas it's far more compelling to have, say, 3 outcomes which each happen 30% of the time, and then 50 incredibly obscure ones which only happen 0.2% of the time. And for instance, a game like The Binding of Isaac, I think, does that quite well, because it has a large number of extremely rare things which can happen. And that makes it kind of quite compelling as something. I think because it gives you kind of, it pretty much always gives you something unusual to latch onto when you're doing a playthrough, I guess is how I put it. And so my thinking in URR was I didn't want that kind of, at the macro generation level, there should be big differences between each world, between each culture, between each whatever. And so like there's lots of hidden functions in the game which basically check if something that's been created is too much like something else. And if it is, then it bins it and re-rolls and tries it again. And that, I think, is a really central part of how URR generates stuff. It kind of foregrounds difference. It's really obsessed with making things different. And to me, a good way of doing that is to have at the kind of at this kind of macro level, a smaller number of really different templates, which then bifurcate after that, because it makes sure that things are always quite different when the player encounters them. Yeah, so it takes up a lot of time, but I must say, when you spend the day creating a procedural ASCII vase, as probably the only person who's ever created a procedural ASCII vase, when you spend a day doing that and it looks bloody great by the end, then you feel, yeah, that was a day well spent. I have created a new piece of interesting generated content, which is meaningfully different from everything else in this world.
And when you start laying out how many generators there are, you already begin to see the scale of this monumental task that Johnson offered onto himself. The actual final number is hard to tell, and Mark himself wasn't entirely sure when I asked. But it means for every possible facet of the game, there is effectively a collection of pre-made, curated options for the generator to select from. But regardless of the number, they vary in depth and complexity given the particular challenge they're designed to tackle. Hence, some generators, even those that are highly critical to the experience, can be very simple, while other, seemingly innocuous elements to the player present massive challenges during development. Now, it's safe to say that all of this sounds cool, but it's also still markedly formulaic. It's not going to result in this plausible, sensible world that players experience in Ultima Ratio Regum, which brings us to the next step of the generative process. Returning to earlier when I discussed the dialect system, it's much more complicated than I originally described. A given culture doesn't just have its own naming conventions and set of common phrases, they also have their own unique forms of expression that reference aspects of their heritage. An NPC you speak to can discuss aspects of their political or religious ideologies, they can comment on a topic by relating it to local geography, or by referencing a well-worn story that is defined in their cultural history. So it's pulling from other parts of the established game world in order to build the dialect. The history, the geography, the political ideologies are already defined before the dialect is established. And this is the real secret behind Ultima Ratio Regum. The chains of meaning we described earlier are achieved by having procedural generators read the output of other generators as part of their own creative process.
A lot of roguelikes have disconnected things, like you'll have a floor on NetHack, and one room contains a lake, and one room has a bunch of leprechauns, and one room has some lava, and one room has a bunch of swords, and one room has a whatever. And there's no links there. It's just a bunch of rooms picked at random. And so I thought, well, what's the kind of extreme antithesis of this? And the answer is connections. Everything should be connected in some way. So every concept should in some way link to every other concept. Someone's, you know, if someone's from a culture where ravens are thought to be lucky, then if the player rocks up with a shield with a raven on, they should go, oh, great shield, I like it. So, and that to me felt extremely un-PCG. And so seeing whether I could PCG a world that didn't look like PCG also seemed both like a cool challenge, but also like a really good way to develop something new and something different and something which wasn't, yeah, just random rooms and so on.
Each generator in Ultima Ratio Regum is designed to solve one specific task within the game. However, all of it connects to one another. The real complexity of the game comes from the order in which generators operate and how the output of one system can influence another. For example, while the generator that handles the creation of the open world is largely unfettered and allowed to build on its own, the generator that names locations uses the open world data to guide its decision-making process. Locations in the game world are all influenced by their local environment. Hence, if you live in a snowy tundra, the name of the location will pull on this motif. Same as if it's in a desert, a forest, a jungle, a swamp. Each of these locations will influence the names of the towns and villages generated. But it doesn't stop there. The location is a piece of information that is fed into even more systems down the line. Crests and cultural symbols, and even the designs of furniture such as vases and chairs, may refer to the local flora or fauna, which will also have been influenced by the local environment. The selected political and religious ideologies can be heavily influenced by where in the world that culture exists. And of course, the aforementioned dialogue system pulls from all of these elements in different ways. And as all of this continues to spiral outwards, each generator has the potential to influence the outcome of another, and a lot of it requires careful consideration and management of potential outcomes, with rules to catch edge cases that don't successfully align with the world being built, and our collective understanding of specific cultural practices. For example, it doesn't make sense for a theocracy, meaning the politics of this region is driven by the belief that a specific god is their supreme authority, to subsequently embrace the idea of religious freedom and allow people to establish their own religions. I mean, sure, that might sound funny, but in practice it would mean everyone is in charge, no order could be established, and everything would be a mess, and that detracts from the design goals of the game. With that emergent complexity in mind, it's interesting to consider how easily the game could find itself in a situation where as new generators are added, the number of new problems that emerge simply explodes, as undesirable outcomes emerge or weird stuff is generated that isn't really within acceptable limits. But the solution is actually down to a simple and straightforward approach by Johnson built around two rules. First, once a generator is written, it doesn't get rebuilt or refactored. Once it's written, it's done. Secondly, when new generators are added, the execution order is not changed. If generator 34 is in development, then when it's finished, it becomes the 34th generator to run when a new world is built. It can't be added in any earlier. Hence, a lot of thought is given to what generators are going to be made next, what existing generators they pull from, and whether the output that generator creates is potentially going to influence something else that's farther down the line on the to-do list.
And so I make sure to always be absolutely comprehensive on every generator I make, so there's no way I will ever have to go back. And although I joked about this at the start, it is true, I don't remember how 90% plus of the generators in the game work. I haven't a clue. They just output their thing, and that's that, and that's fine.
This markedly linear and irreversible nature of the existing generators actually helps mitigate development woes down the line. Given a game of this magnitude could easily run another 10 years if systems were refactored or rebuilt as new ideas crept in. That said, it has led to some interesting quirks and hacks along the way.
But then the second half of it is that sometimes I have had to do some fairly kind of hacky techniques to connect different generators. One which I'm not proud of, there's two which both output graphics, and I had finished them both if I wanted to link them. And so rather than having them linked, basically one of them just looks at what character the other one printed on screen and then makes choices based on that. So it looks kind of purely at the console's output rather than any part of the generator itself, which is truly shameful, but now it's out there in public. I guess the most crucial thing on some level is making sure that you put in a new generator at the right point as well. So kind of everything new is always created after everything that I've already done. And so I never kind of go back and put a new one between 6 and 7. Anything new always goes in at the end. And so what that also means is there's a few points where to the player, it looks like X generated Y, but actually Y generated X, and then X is made in such a way as to make it look like X created Y. Because I did that one later than the other one, but I couldn't work out how to go back and fit it in. So yeah, there's an interesting number of hacky fixes and these sorts of things in there.
Looking back on the 10 years spent, Like any long-term creative endeavour, there's much of that experience to reflect on. But it's not just in terms of the creative outputs, it's also the very personal experience of the man behind it. Ultima Ratio Regum has developed a community of players and supporters who follow it, with fans following along with the development of each new release, not to mention that the game itself has over 100,000 downloads over the 10-year period, with his personal website receiving millions of hits over the years as people log on to find out more about the game. Plus, URR has also achieved prominence in game development communities, with Johnson delivering talks at roguelike events all around the world, not to mention the likes of ProcJam, Nuclei, and even GDC Europe. It's an experience that has also had a profound personal impact on Mark's life, but in some ways you might not expect. As mentioned earlier, Mark suffered severe health problems in the early years of development, and URR provided something of a coping mechanism as means to focus his energies on something productive.
After about 2 years, so in late 2023, I became very ill and nearly died, and basically a large part of the work ethic, both in URR and in my academic work, was, in essence, it was almost a kind of displacement activity, that if I worked on these productive projects, then I wasn't thinking about my own mortality and the fact that my life had just exploded, basically. So in the real peak period of both programming and my academic output, which is sort of 2014 until 2018, let's say, 2017, 2018, in that peak period of output, yeah, I mean, for most of that, I was posting weekly updates, or at worst, fortnightly updates. I was publishing like 10 papers a year or something insane, and going to every conference I could find. So that was largely kind of what took me in that direction, I think. And it worked on a kind of narrow metric of, is this continuing to get coding done? On that kind of narrow metric, it worked well.
But as these projects linger, the pressure of continuing on and delivering on your goals can feel substantial, even if that pressure is brought on by your own aspirations. URR arose during what could be argued as a more streamlined and simpler period of Mark's life. While conducting his PhD research would be demanding, it's still a single attainable goal over a several year period. And, speaking from my own experience, quite often other larger aspirational goals are still a far-flung idea. But of course, Johnson graduated from his PhD, and the larger concerns of moving on and building a career from that position became paramount. This led to a period as a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Alberta, starting in 2017, followed by his position at the University of Sydney from 2019 until now, all of which based in a research area that is completely disparate from the game itself. And it can prove challenging to balance the needs of side projects against your larger career goals, and the cognitive load that bears down on a person. As a result, burnout can arise all too easily, or a lack of motivation, as the original drive becomes lost in a sea of influences and expectations. But while the project was effectively put on ice for over a year, the recent 0.8 release is a rekindling of the fires that drove Johnson to begin with. And while the question of whether URR ever reaches a 1.0 release is still an open one, it's encouraging to see that Mark's passions for his work have realigned in a healthier and more pragmatic form.
Yeah, I mean, I basically stopped working on it from kind of mid-2018/early 2018 up until about 6 months ago. And that was just because academia is quite a demanding career, as you know. And there were three factors. One was an intensification of my academic work, because I wanted a tenured job with some research time. So that was one part of it. A second part of it was a recurrence of some ill health stuff. And the third part of it, not to preempt a future question, but a third part of it was that my motivations had become very extrinsic rather than intrinsic. I was very much doing it because I felt obliged to, rather than because I wanted to. And that's not really a good motivator. So the combo of career, health, and changed motivations was a pretty powerful combo to basically bring development to a halt about 2.5 years ago. Yeah. In general, my fans have been extraordinarily supportive and patient. No, it's solely an internal thing. That just over time, my motivation shifted from, like I say, kind of intrinsic to extrinsic ones. My interest shifted from I want to make a game, I want to make something new, I want to explore new PCG things, I want to create a finished product, all these kind of intrinsic things over time became less central to my motivation than people expect a blog post, people expect an update, people want to see new stuff and new content, and people are excited. And I think this was intensified because during the really bad ill health period in 2013, 2014, although they didn't know it at the time, my fans were a big part of what kept me going. And so I did feel a certain need to repay, repay that. And so all these things basically kind of, like I think I said at the start, it was one of those things which happens so slowly, you don't notice it day by day, but then after a few years, you look back and you think, wow, this has changed completely. And just one day in kind of late 2017, I just realized, I no longer actually want to work on this. I am only doing it because I feel I have to, because I feel I should, because there are tens of thousands, if not six figures worth of people who've downloaded this game, and there are many people who comment a lot, and there's always people on like the Roguelike subreddit or the Roguelike Discord or the Roguelike thread on something awful. These sorts of places, there's always people talking about it and always people saying, I wish there was a new version. Yeah, so over time I just felt obliged. But then once I realized I had come to feel obliged, I suddenly felt, I just don't want to do this anymore. And it's not really accurate to say I did no URR for that kind of 2 year period. I did do some. There were always kind of a good day or a good week when I'd really feel like, yeah, let's finish this system, or let's bug fix this issue or something. But in general, there wasn't really a lot of dev going on in that 2 year block. So although people use the word burn, the phrase burnout a lot, I don't think it was burnout in this particular case, because I have experienced burnout from my academic work, and this was a different sensation. It wasn't burnout as just a loss of motivation, rather, and while that is one component of burnout, I feel burnout has several different facets, whereas this sensation only had that one facet of, I just no longer feel motivated to do this. And I felt really bad about it. I mean, this racked me with guilt. But I basically just promised myself that one day I would come back to it. And I am proud and pleased to say that that has turned out to be true. But I definitely needed that 2 year break, both to work on health stuff and to get a good academic post and to just renew my interest in having it finished. I think if I kept going, I would have imploded in some way. Yeah.
And as our conversation concluded, Mark not only reflected on the changes in his life that had enabled for his return to the project, but also on the mistakes made along the way, which might prove useful for others, even if you don't plan on spending 10 years making your next passion project.
Just like it was a confluence of different events or trends that took me away from it, it was a confluence of things that brought me back. It wasn't just one thing. I went back to it partly because I'd had such a long gap, I felt motivated again. That was a big part, of course. But it was also that in my academic career, I'm really trying to take on fewer projects right now and trying to clear out my kind of list of stuff to do. The last year, I've been doing about two-thirds as many projects as I have for the last 5 years. And so I have made a genuine kind of meaningful change there to taking on fewer projects and to finishing off older projects. And so I was and still am in a kind of period of just go back to all your old stuff and just get it done. Just get it finished and just get it and just move on. Because also, I think I was feeling a little bit paralyzed, both in terms of game making and in terms of my academic life, by just having so many projects that were half done rather than a small number which are being done and a large number which are finished. And you are nodding with appreciation and deep understanding, I think. And then the third reason was unanticipated, but when I first booted it back up after about a year and a half of no dev, I was really amazed by it. And to be super clear on this, I'm not saying that in some kind of brag, my God, I made the most amazing thing. I'm not saying that. I'm just saying I had forgotten how much work I put into it, and I'd forgotten what I'd been able to create, and I'd forgotten that it was actually quite interesting and quite good. And when I first went back to it, I thought, you know what, this is actually not bad. Let's finish it. I think there's a 25% chance I will do a 0.9, but if I do, it will be completely secret until it's done, and then I will just release it one day. I'd say there's a 50% chance I will at some point in my life work on some other smaller game. And I'd say there's a 25% chance I'll just never make another game. It's very hard to say at this point, I think, where things will go from here. But I think those odds are roughly correct. 50% something else, 25% a bit more URR, 25% I'm done with game making. Looking back, I think I made three mistakes is too harsh, but let's go with that. Which was having this be a one-person project, writing this in Python rather than something easier like, say, GameMaker, and making it public from day one. Those were the three mistakes I made. Because having it be a one-person project is a downside for many obvious reasons. And then in terms of Python, I mean, Python is clearly not the hardest thing on earth to code in, but it's not the easiest either. And for someone who'd never coded anything in their life, it might have been a good idea to start with something even easier, perhaps. And then the third thing is that just because I was public from day one, the risk of that inevitable eventual shift to extrinsic, I think, was there from day one. So if I do ever make a game again, it will be with lots of people. It'll be in Game Maker or something like that. And it will be secret until it's finished. And I think with those three options, I think I have a realistic chance of making another game and finishing it as well. But the thing I'm proudest of is the fact that it's still going, is the fact that I taught myself to program and manage to create this, is the fact that after a life-threatening event, I was still able to keep going with it, is the fact that I am going to get 0.8 out. Yeah, it's the fact that in spite of, again, not to sound self-pitying, but in spite of a tremendous volume of shit, it is still going and it's still actually pretty interesting.
Ultima Ratio Regum continues to address its larger design goals with each new release, as every new update brings new and exciting innovations that culturally enrich each procedurally generated world, adding depth and complexity to every new settlement. Their larger political motivations, character interactions and behaviour, and even the most mundane of things, such as a vase you might find sitting on a random table. It's a celebration not just of the level of creativity you can achieve with procedural generation, but proof that the chains of meaning that Johnson advocated for can result in ones that feel rich and complex. Perhaps most importantly, it's a testimony to a creative endeavour that has survived for close to a decade and has developed an audience eager to try out every new release. Whether the final argument is ever delivered is still an open question, but one can safely say that the game has already made a fairly definitive statement. Thank you for watching this episode of AI in Games and joining me on this journey through the inner workings of Ultima Ratio Regum. A special thank you to Mark Johnson himself, who took the time to chat with me about the game, and I really appreciate him lending a very personal perspective in what has been a substantially rewarding and challenging period of his life. For those of you keen to play Ultima Ratio Regum, explore its inner workings in more detail, or perhaps even explore some of Mark's games research, links are provided for you in the video description to check out. This episode of AI in Games was voted for and funded by my supporters on Patreon, with a special thanks to patron Berhard Werner for his ongoing support of the show. You can find out more about the AI in Games Patreon by the links on screen and in the description. Take care, folks. I'll be back.